geo, its size, disadvantages and advantages. In this tutorial, we'll learn about Verilog, which is a type of HTML. So let's start with it. The basic building, and we give a functionality of the design which tells us what the design does exactly. So module and end module are the keywords that are used in the in Verilog, and every design should have these keywords. So now the module declarations, we cannot use, like we cannot write module inside module, so we cannot use a nested module module declarations, but we can use module inside a module, like we can declare another module inside a top module. So we'll come to know how we instantiate it in later slides. Currently you just need to know that modules can be declared and it can be instantiated in other modules. So a Verilog module in general may contain all these, it may not contain some of these, but some of these are always present. So we'll look at it one by one in the slides as we go on. So as you see, there I have mentioned two types of codes here. So the difference in here is Verilog was first developed by Gateway Automation Design in 1995, and it was standardized 13 Verilog 1394, and it was then reviewed, and again in 2001 there was a upgradation of the standard. So now the standard is merged into a system Verilog group, but but the two styles that I have shown, the first one is a new one and the second one is a older one. So in the older design we had to mention the ports direction separately, like output input separately, but in the new design we can put it together. Also each port has data types, so in the older design we had to specify the data type separately. Here I have not shown because I wanted to make it simple. We'll know later what a data type and how ports and data types are related. So this is a basic Verilog module. So next we'll see what are ports and comments in a Verilog code. So ports, as I discussed earlier, there can be three types: input ports, output ports and in-out ports as per the design specification. And they can be in single bit ports and they can be multiple bit ports, so we call them scalar and vector. And you can see the examples here: input and the keyword, and output and the keyword, and similarly we will have in out and some keyword. So we can declare a single bit single bit port or a multiple bit port, and in multiple bit port the range can vary from MSB to LSB, left to right, and it can take any value. So in Verilog we can mention 2:1, we can mention 7:0 or 0:4. So we'll see later which kind of technique we use generally in practice. So but this is possible, so we can mention any type of range in a vector. So coming to the comments part of Verilog, it is similar to C programming. It has single block, single comment and a block comment, and single line starts with double slash and block comment starts with slash star. So this is an example of how we use a comment line in Verilog. So this whole is not executed at all, it is treated as a comment, and we can describe the design, what the design is going to do using a block comment, or we can describe what a line does in a single line comment. So next we'll learn about levels of modeling in Verilog. So we have three basic type of levels in Verilog: structural, data flow and behavioral. So we'll go through them one by one, but in this slide I just want you to know that there are three kinds of levels, like the way in which we model a design. So there are specific ways in which we model a design in Verilog. So in the structural module modeling, we use primitives and low level module instantiation. It's similar to making a schematic. So we know the basic building block of the design and we just instantiate the basic gates in the, so it is very close to physical implementation and it is very easy to synthesize. So it's more efficient if you compare with the data flow and behavioral model. We'll see in detail structure modeling. And in data modeling, the input signal transformations are defined in terms of output. Output signals are defined in terms of input signal transformation. So if there is any change in input, we'll make the output look like the output is represented according to the input change. So the main disadvantage of data flow is we cannot model a memory element using a data flow model. Third is behavioral model. This is the most used model as of now. It doesn't require for us to know the basic building block. We can specify the code in an algorithmic manner, and since it's close to a natural language description, it's very difficult to synthesize because the tool doesn't know what we are asking the tool to design. So this works best for verification purpose, for testing the system, but we'll see why we use this mode. Like, we use generally data flow and behavioral mixed in practice, and we generally don't prefer structural modeling. We'll see why we don't use it. So I'll first discuss what is structural modeling and how it is advantageous, and what are the disadvantage of structural modeling. So in structural modeling, we use logic gates and user defined components connected using wires. So as you can see in the slide, I have taken an example of a 2:1 multiplexer. So a 2:1 multiplexer looks something like this. We have two inputs and an output and one select line. This is a 2:1 multiplexer, and we have I0 and I1 as input and select as input also, and we have a Z output. So the module that I have defined is a MUX, 2:1 MUX, so MUX2. MUX2 is the keyword, and I have a Z as output, I0 as input, I1 as input, and a select line. So the functionality of this MUX is defined in a way that when there is a change in select line, like when the select line is 0, we get an output of I0, and when the select line is 1, we get an output of I1. So this is a basic functionality that we need the MUX to operate like. So if you know digital design concept, this functionality can be represented using a Boolean equation. And the Boolean equation comes like something like this. So Z equal to select bar I0 plus select I1. So if you see the code here in the slide, we directly represent this Boolean equation in the form of logic gates. So we have one multiplication in the equation, two ANDs in the equation, and one OR. So we use two AND gate, one OR gate, and this NOT is for the select NOT in the multiplexer design. So in a structural modeling, we use directly the logic gates to describe a design functionality, and in Verilog language we have predefined gates like wire, NOT, AND, OR, NOR, etc., which need not be declared. We can directly use it in the code. So that is predefined in the Verilog language. The advantages of this kind of modeling is that it is hand designed, so we know exactly what the design does, and it is most efficient because we are actually thinking about the hardware. What is the hardware that is required to do the job? And moreover, if we use AND gate, OR gate, etc., we know that they are predefined, and there won't be any problems with that pre-existing designs. So they are proven sub-blocks, and we have some of these IP cores available as libraries or Verilog predefined language. So these are the advantages of structural modeling. The disadvantages are that if the design becomes very big and we don't know what hardware a particular functionality will give, so So then it becomes very difficult to use structural modeling, and we may not always know the hardware of the architecture of the design. So also to get into, if at all we decide to use structural modeling, to know the actual hardware of each functionality is difficult and it will take a lot of time. So for a higher level design, for complex design, it's very difficult to work with structural model. So we saw how we use predefined gaze earlier in structure modeling. So we call them primitives. So if you can see here, I have taken an example of adder. This is a 1-bit adder I have taken, which has a sum and a carry output, three inputs A, B, and C. So if I draw it, I have a 1-bit adder circuit. I have A and B as two inputs to be added, 1-bit inputs. C in is a 1-bit carry in, and we get sum and a carry out. So I will describe how primitives are used in Verilog. So there is a way that primitives are instantiated or used inside a Verilog model. So each primitives have inputs and outputs. Outputs are specified at first, like the first thing that comes during the instantiation of a primitive is the output. So we always specify what is the output first and then the number of inputs. Generally primitives have only one output and many number of inputs. So there are no language restrictions, but generally it depends on the technology that we use. Like the number of inputs and output depends on the technology we use. So we can optionally specify delays of the AND gates. Like we can put AND hash 1, 2 something, which defines the propagation delay or other delays in this particular gate. Also the combinational gates, these XOR, AND, OR, is readily available in Verilog as primitives. So some of the examples of primitives are AND, NAND, OR, NOR, NOT, and all this. So we now know how to use a primitive in a structural modeling and what are the advantages and disadvantages of structural modeling. Now we will see what a component instantiation is. So I have been talking about instantiation, right? So instantiation is nothing but using a predefined module in a top module, in another module. So suppose, like in the earlier example, I spoke about 2:1 mux. So we defined that 2:1 mux with the keyword mux 2. So we'll see how we'll use this mux 2 to create a 4:1 mux. So here in the example, I am using mux 2 as a predefined module in the top module mux 4. So if I draw the diagram, so we have 3:1 mux, these are 3:1 mux, and we use them to create a 4:1 mux. So this is a 4:1 mux. So if you see the design, we have in a 4:1 mux, we have D0, D1, we have D2, sorry, this is not D2, D2, D3, and we have an output Z. We have a select line which is 2 bits. So we'll use one select line for these two muxes and one select line for this mux. So we use 2:1 mux to create 4:1 mux. And we will instantiate the 2:1 mux inside the mux 4 module and see how component instantiation works. So component instantiation can be done in two ways. First thing is it can be called by reference and it can be called by position. It's somewhat similar to C calling, C function calling, but it's not actually that. So I'll tell you how it is done. So the currently whatever you see in this slide in the code, this is by reference. So we provide dot select dot I0 dot I1 dot z. These are the ports of MUX2. We have I0 I1 as input, we have z as output, and one select line. So we instantiate MUX2 using calling by reference using this procedure, this syntax. So we specify ports in dot port name and the net that connects it. So all these modules are connected by, all the MUXes are connected by other wires, right? So these are called internal nets. So we have to declare them. So that's why I have used wire Z1, Z2. This is a data type that we'll discuss later. So component instantiations, like what we spoke about earlier, it does not include delay, but it should include a name, component name. Like I have three MUXes, I have named them M1, M2, M3. So before we do a simulation of this whole module, if we want to test this 4:1 MUX, if it is operating properly, if we want to simulate this, we first have to synthesize this individual module and then use them. So this is how a general component instantiation works. There may be more parameters, more things that can be added. This is the basic thing. So we'll see how more Verilog constructs can be added in the later slides. So now we know what is structural modeling and its disadvantages. Now we will discuss about data flow modeling, which is basically modeling the output with respect to input. So all the data flow modeling codes start with continuous assignment statements. So continuous assignment statement is basically representing output in terms of input. So we use assign keyword for a continuous assignment statement, and they are executed parallelly. So if you see the example of MUX2, instead of using a structural modeling, I have here used data flow modeling. I have used assign keyword, and I have used operators. These are called operators and operands. So inputs are called operands, and we have operators, and we get the output according to the change in the input. The different assigned statement inside a data flow modeling is executed parallelly, and they can represent propagation delays. So we can put that z bar comes after some phi time delay of z. So we can specify. So I have not put it here so that you know the basic of data flow modeling. So we know now that the execution model called data flow has data values flowing through the network through wires and operators. So basically data flow modeling is described using continuous assignment statements, which tells us how output changes with respect of input, and it uses operators. Okay, so the main disadvantage of data flow modeling is it doesn't have constructs to design a memory element. We can only design a combinational circuit using data flow modeling. It's very difficult to design a memory element using data flow modeling. So that's why we came up with a behavioral modeling style, and we'll see in later slides how we do a behavioral modeling model code. So before we go into behavioral modeling, I want to tell you about more Verilog language constructs and how it is used. So we'll see what are vectors and parameters in Verilog language. So parameters are nothing but something we want to declare, we want to change in the module after something. Suppose we have instantiated the MUX2 module inside the MUX4 module, and instead of 1-bit input, we want some 2-bit, multiple bit inputs in the MUX. For example, we define this 2:1 MUX. So in this, each input was 1 bit, right? But now we want we have a requirement that we want the data to be multiple bits. Suppose this has to be 8 bits and output has to be 8 bits and we have a select line. So to model this kind of structure, for our code to be independent of the change in number of bits, we define something called parameter. So we define a width w of the data as shown in the slide. We define is using a keyword parameter, which is represented like this, hash parameter w, and by default it takes a value of 1 for a 2:1 marks. But when we use it in another module, if it is not declared in another module, it will take the default value w1. If it is if we use the w equal to 2 in another module and use this mux 2 inside mux 4, then the mux 2 takes the value that has the top module that it takes the value that top module describes. So it overrides the initial coding that we have done, but it will take the top level parameter value. So this is how we use a parameter. In this way we can use a parameterized module. So we can define different kinds of muxes with different inputs. We don't have to every time change the basic mux 2 module to get a multiple bit data mux. So this is how we do modular codes in Verilog, so that we can use a single code for different purposes without changing much of the code. So hope you have understood how I have used the parameter here. So this is about the parameter and about the vectors. So I told about ports which can be declared like multiple bits. So multiple bit signals are called vectors, and they can be declared as high to low or low to high, like 1:2 or 6:1, something like that. So the common usage that we use in that we have in practice is MSB to LSB, where MSB is greater than LSB and LSB is generally 0. But we can use we can use part vector in the design. So we can suppose if the carry wires are declared as n:0, suppose n is some 5, some carry wire is a 6-bit wire and vector, sorry, carry wire is a 6-bit vector, and we have 5:0 as carry wire declared, and we can access each bit separately, or we can use a bunch of bits and assign them some values. So we can use them to assign it to a output, or we can assign them a constant. So this is how we use a vector in the design. So next we'll see what are the basic language conventions and semantics. So Verilog is a case sensitive language, and we generally don't use a case sensitive feature because it makes the design very difficult to debug. If in case you have made a mistake, it's very difficult to debug. So all the keywords are in lower case generally, and different names should be used for different designs. Like I have used mux 2 for 2:1 mux, mux 4 for 4:1 mux. So we should do different names for different scope. And the identifiers, like the names that I use for a module or for an instantiated module, should have uppercase or can have uppercase or lowercase alphabets, decimal digits, or underscores. And the semantics that we can use in a Verilog language is that every line of the code is ended with a semicolon. We can have two types of comments. We have compiler directives, which I'll come to later. We have built-in system tasks and functions, which start with dollar, and we have strings enclosed in double colon. Okay. So in Verilog, we spoke about wires. So wires are generally four-valued logic, and they can take four values. So the we are designing a hardware. So hardware will a particular hardware will have nets or wires connected between each other. So we have to think about what the values in the hardware it can take. So generally we know about 0 and 1, which corresponds to a voltage level plus 5 or minus 5 or plus 3.3 minus 3.3, but we don't know about X and Z. But the Verilog language allows us to define a signal as with following values: 0, 1, X and Z. 0 belonging to low, 1 belonging to high, X belonging to an unknown value, and Z belonging to a high impedance state of the signal. So X is generally used in simulation. In practice or in hardware, there is nothing called as X, and Z means high impedance, that the line is not driven by anything or it is idle. So these are the values that we use in Verilog code for a particular wire or net. So why we use X is that we can have multiple signal driving a same signal. So to find the conflict between that, we use X, and we initialize sometimes values as X so that we can distinguish between the later values that it can take, and this is generally used in simulation. When why we use Z, we use Z so that we know that no other signal is driving it and the line is idle. Verilog also has some other drive strength properties that we can use with the signals, which we will not discuss and which is not generally used. So we now know that Verilog has signals which are represented in four valued logic. So I think we are out of time now. So I'll stop this session here, and I'll continue this in the next session.